In other news, the Philippine government has approved a 95 billion peso elevated expressway project that will be built on top of the Pasig River. The Pasig River Expressway, or PAREX, will cover 19.37 kilometers from Radon Road 10 in Manila to C6 Road, with 6 lanes and a connection to Skyway 3. Its proponent, San Miguel Corporation, signed a supplemental toll operations agreement last week with transport authorities. But many environmental groups, conservation advocates, and even groups pushing for sustainable transportation are opposing the project. Joining us this morning to talk more about this is Alt Mobility PH Director Ira Cruz. Alt Mobility PH is a nonprofit organization composed of volunteers and urban transport professionals. Good morning, Ira. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Mike. Thank you for inviting us today.
Now, we have also reached out to San Miguel Corporation, but they did not send any representative to discuss this issue. Now, Ira, first off, the goal of PAREX is supposedly to decongest C5, EDSA, and other major road networks. Your group thinks this will not happen. Tell us why.
You know, Mike, Alt Mobility PH, we've been advocating for better policies for transportation. And the only way to improve mobility for all is to provide infrastructure that will offer other forms of transportation for people. You know, public transportation, biking, walking. You know, think about this, Mike. For decades, we've been building roads, road widening, building flyovers and expressways. And yet, here we still are. We continue to suffer through congested roads, spending hours on the road to go to work, run errands, or to be with our loved ones. You know, and then that's happening because of what we call an induced demand. Induced demand is as we increase the supply of one thing, you know, in this case, the roads for cars, we encourage people to keep on driving. So, you know, while we might see some easing of congestion at the beginning of projects like this, demands will just eventually catch up and we're back to where we began. And that's precisely why PAREX is not the solution. Only by providing superior public transportation, quality and human-centered infrastructure for biking and walking can we truly decongest the roads by using limited city space more efficiently. In fact, that improves mobility for all.
Mm-hmm. And one of the concerns, Ira, is that this expressway will be toll regulated. So it's not open for everyone, but only to those who are willing to pay. So will this ultimately benefit the public?
You know, Mike, that's the other thing that we have been trying to raise. We've been called, you know, unprogressive. But really, when you think about that, when you think about this, only 12 to 20% of household own cars. So the question is, whose progress are they really working towards? You know, flip that number. You know, about 88% of households don't own cars. So what about their progress? And as you've mentioned, you're right. This is a toll road and this won't be free.
But the counter argument to that, Ira, is that they're saying if you reduce the number of vehicles using the other routes, you might ease the traffic jam in those areas by, you know, providing an alternative route. Do you think this will work?
Well, as I've mentioned earlier, Mike, we've seen this through the years. For several decades now, we've done just that. You know, PAREX is what, you know, what Einstein calls as doing the same things over and over and just expecting a different result. Unfortunately, that's not going to be the case here. And we really fear that, you know, it's not just about worsening traffic as it is. If PAREX is built, it will most likely have environmental repercussions and aggravate health issues. If PAREX is built, it will put in danger very important heritage historical properties along the river. You know, important built heritage, such as the Manila Post Office, Intramuros, Escolta, Malacanang. And we risk all of this only to learn at the end of the day that PAREX just added to road congestion. You know, San Miguel Corporation will pay for the construction today, but how much will it cost us in the future when we realize that we need to take it down because it's a huge mistake? And this is not conjecture, right? This has happened in several cities like Seoul and Korea. You know, building PAREX, as I've said, is doing the same things over and over and expecting a different result.
Now let's talk about the environmental impact of the project. San Miguel Corporation said they will invest in the rehabilitation of Pasig River as part of the project. How feasible is this? Some environmental groups have said that the construction of the expressway alone will pollute the Pasig River itself.
Right. So as I mentioned earlier, it will induce demand and greenhouse gas emissions. Transportation actually accounts for a huge chunk of greenhouse gas emissions. So inducing demand further by encouraging more people to drive will bring, you know, noise pollution, air pollution to all of these communities. And obviously, the more people use cars, the larger the contribution of transportation would be to air pollution.
What about the effect on Pasig River itself? Because when the expressway does get built, this will mean that a portion of Pasig River will be blocked from receiving direct sunlight. Some environmental groups have pointed out this will adversely affect the ecosystem in Pasig River. But the counter argument to that is that, is there an ecosystem left to save anyway?
Well, you know, there have been several initiatives in the past several years to revive Pasig River. And what this does is that San Miguel and the DOT are just citing the death sentence of Pasig River. By building Parecs on Parecs, you literally throw out all of the initiatives and efforts that are being done to revive Pasig River. To think about this, how can building columns to support a 19-kilometer six-lane expressway fix Pasig River? And yet they're claiming that it will clean up Pasig River. If they really want to clean up Pasig River, I invite them to really focus efforts on cleaning up the river. You know, they offer green solutions, like they say that it's going to feature a bike lane. But Mike, you don't need a six-lane expressway for bike lanes. You can quite easily build that on the embankment, and most likely for a much less cost, and obviously a lot less damage to the environment and to our heritage.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned Seoul a while ago, and one of the examples cited against Parecs is the Chung-Gye-Chun River in Seoul, South Korea. Once covered by concrete roads and elevated highway, it is now an open stream that supposedly helps cool down the temperature along nearby areas. We are doing the reverse. Is there reason to believe temperatures along Pasig River will rise and pollution levels will go up once Parecs will be put up?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, Mike, they say hindsight is 2020, but we don't need hindsight. The proof is right in front of us. Do we need to make the same mistake as a lot of these other countries? We should learn from their mistakes. Why should we go through the same mistakes while we can quite easily learn from the experience of all these other countries? You know, when Korea took down their flyover, they in fact reported better mobility for everybody. And that's precisely what we want for everybody in Metro Manila.
Now, one of the concerns, Ira, is that isn't it too late for the Philippines actually to catch up with these countries? Because the difference between Seoul and Manila is that in Seoul, you have a very well-developed public transport system. Here in Manila, you have only a few options. That's why people are forced to buy cars and use cars. Is it too late for us to actually catch up?
Absolutely not. You know, back in 2019, our group collaborated with Congress in drafting a Magna Carta for commuters and a commuter bill of rights. You know, this just goes to show that we really believe, and there are a lot of ways by which we can rehabilitate public transportation or mobility in the country. You know, even before the pandemic, we were already calling it. We are in a transport crisis, but we had no idea it's even going to spiral further. I want to talk about this a little bit more, Mike, because with the suspension of public transportation at the beginning of the pandemic and the slow reinstatement of routes and authorization from LTFRB, people are waiting for hours for a ride in a limited congested public transportation. transportation. So this actually is now as much of a health issue. Thousands of people risk their lives every day biking through hostile streets that continue to prioritize cars. This is the 88% whose progress the government really needs to be concerned about. And according to the PSA, the transport sector is one of the worst hit during the pandemic. This is progress, and this is what we need to focus on. So if we introduce changes in public transportation and active transportation, it's not too late. And, you know, I'd like to show these numbers, though. Based on the calculations of the Move As One Coalition, of which Altmobility PH is a member, we need about $14 billion in order to create active transportation facilities like bike lanes and bike racks, and about 76 billion pesos for service contracting. And this is not only addressing the unbelievably insufficient supply of public transportation, but also provides jobs, the sustainable kind of jobs. And, you know, Mike, that's only a total of 90 billion, still short of the 95 billion to be spent on tariffs. And so for the same amount of money, we can make a larger difference in terms of mobility for the country, and not just mobility for a few, but mobility for all.
Mm-hmm. Now, lastly, Ira, let's talk about the impact of this project on heritage sites along Pasig River. How do you think this will affect heritage sites along the Pasig River?
Well, first of all, Mike, the pollution that it will bring from construction to operation will gravely affect all of these establishments, all of these what we call important built heritage. Number two, they're not built to withstand the vibrations of the construction or even the operation. And, you know, for a lot of these important built heritage, they will be blocked by Parex. The views of the Manila Post Office, which we all enjoy when we go to Binondo, will forever be gone. It will put to risk the walls of Intramuros. And many others that we shouldn't be risking for a solution that will not deliver the promise that it supposedly promises.
Mm-hmm. All right, you've discussed a while ago the numbers, how much it will cost to put up alternatives instead of spending 95 billion on Parex. But what can we do for now, immediately? I mean, there is a need to address the traffic jam, although we're still in the midst of a pandemic, but you've seen the cars, the number of cars going out. And so it seems like we're back to pre-pandemic levels. What can we do in the short term to be able to address this problem?
You know, Mike, thousands of people, even before the pandemic, has been relying on biking as a main form of transportation. You know, building bike lanes, even pop-up bike lanes, using things like traffic cones or even POTS, are things that we can already implement today. We've seen this in several cities like Pasig City, San Juan, Quezon City. They've implemented a lot of these things for a lot less and for a much shorter span of time. And it's already making a difference in the lives of many people. Again, we need to be able to give people an alternative to driving cars, because if people are just forced to drive a car, then we will just be in an endless cycle of induced demand, and we will never be able to get anywhere, regardless of mode of transport.
All right. Thanks for joining us this morning, Ira Cruz of Altmobility PH.
Thanks so much.